Everyone, today we will discuss about the chemistry of quinine, a wonderful molecule which is used as anti-malarial agent. As you all knew, malaria is one of the most dreadful disease in the 18th, 19th and before that, 19th century and before that. And since long ago, people have been using quinine bark and its extract and preparations for treating malaria. But nobody knows why the bark extract is acting as an anti-malarial agent. Nobody knows what is responsible for that and the biological active constituent. So over a period of time, several scientists, including Pellacier, Caventou, William Henry Perkin, Hoffman, the great professors like Woodward, Paul Rabie, Gilbert Stark, and many more people, they worked on, some of them isolated the molecule, some of them worked really, really hard to determine the two-dimensional structure and three-dimensional structure. Some of them contributed to synthesis of the quinine molecule. Let's see one by one. Quinine is an alkaloid obtained from the bark Cinchona officinalis, and this is one of the oldest and very potent anti-malarial agent, as we all knew this one. It was isolated in its pure crystalline format as a sulfate salt by Pellacier and Caventou. So this is one of the oldest alkaloid to be isolated in its pure form. Then people wanted to know what that crystalline material is, so structural elucidation was done. Because at that time, whatever tools that are available, chemistry tools, chemical reactions, etc., with the tools whatever are available, quinine structure was elucidated. So as a first step, quinine's molecular formula was successfully determined to be C20H24N2O2 by Strecker in 1854. That is the first step. So what is the use of molecular formula? If you substitute the molecular formula, you will find out the degrees of unsaturation. So if you substitute 2 into carbon means 2 into 20 plus 2 plus 2 minus 24 minus 0 by 2 should give you number of unsaturations as 10. If you compare the number of carbons to number of unsaturations, so for 20 carbons and 2 nitrogens and oxygens, we have 10 unsaturations, means 10 double bonds or several of the rings and multiple bonds. So this indicates right now for us that the compound may contain an aromatic ring. That is an indication. Now, because in an alkaloid, it is very much necessary to understand the nature of nitrogen. So nature of nitrogen was analyzed in this way. Quinine was treated with methyl iodide at room temperature, so it gave them quinine monoethyl iodide, because this is a quaternary ammonium salt. So when a molecule is consuming 1 mole of alkyl iodide and giving them a quaternary ammonium salt, that indicates that the compound contains a tertiary amine. Tertiary amine means nitrogen connected to 3 different carbons or 3 different bonds other than hydrogen. But upon severe alkylation like ethyl iodide and 100 degree centigrade for 8 hours, it gave them quinine diethyl iodide, which is yellow in color. That means quinine contained 2 nitrogens, as you all have seen. This one molecular formula indicates the 2 nitrogens are there. Both nitrogens are nucleophilic in nature, but one of them is strongly nucleophilic, so that's why it is readily reacting with ethyl iodide to give you monoethyl iodide. Further, when quinine monoethyl iodide was treated with the excess of ethyl iodide at close to 80 degree centigrade, it gave them quinine diethyl iodide. That means the second nitrogen is not very much nucleophilic. So maybe the nitrogen is not actually an aliphatic nitrogen. So these studies indicated that quinine contains. 2 tertiary amines for sure, because it ultimately consumed 2 moles of ethyl iodide to give us the quaternary ammonium salts. And one of the nitrogen may be a part of a chromophore like this. So this could be an aromatic ring where nitrogen is not very much nucleophilic. Aromatic nitrogen containing heterocycle. So now the nature of oxygen. Nature of oxygen, because we have 2 oxygens are there. When two oxygens are there, you yourself can find out what type of functional groups can be there. Like 2 oxygens, aldehyde or a ketone, or carboxylic acid where COOH accounts for 2 oxygens, ethers, all these can be there. So quinine was in fact tested for all these compounds, but here I am presenting only the successful reactions. Quinine upon acetylation, it gave them a monoacetyl quinine. Monoacetyl means either NH is needed or OH is needed. Just now we have confirmed that nitrogen is not a secondary or primary, it is a tertiary nitrogen. So though it is nucleophilic, it cannot undergo acylation. So that's why quinine, one of the oxygen over here must be a hydroxy group. That's why it is forming a monoacetyl derivative. So this monoacetyl derivative upon hydrolysis is giving back quinine. So this clearly indicates that the compound contains an aliphatic hydroxy group. Simple hydroxy group. I cannot say aliphatic or aromatic because both will undergo acylation. So one hydroxy group is there. Quinine upon treatment with HCl, it gave them a compound we call it as epoquinine. So this is what we call it as a sealed tube hydrolysis. We will take quinine, add hydrochloric acid, seal the ampule and then heat it to 150 degrees centigrade. So epoquinine has come, and then along with that they also found methylene chloride, CH3Cl. So how this is possible? How this is possible? So this is possible only when a removable methyl group is there in quinine, which upon treatment with HCl undergoes substitution reaction so that methylene chloride is coming. So one of the possibility is methoxy. But this epoquinine upon anhydride treatment gave diacetyl epoquinone. Diacetyl epoquinine. This indicates that epoquinine is actually a dimethyl derivative of quinine. Hence, one methoxy group is also there. So the 2 oxygens that we have in quinine, one of them is an simple hydroxy group, the other one is a methoxy group. Okay, so in this way 2 oxygens are now accounted for. There is no carboxylic acid group, aldehyde group or ketone group in quinine. Only hydroxy group is there and a methoxy group is there. So then presence of C double bond CH2 in quinine, because as we already knew the structure, so that's why I'm jumping into the individual fragments that are present in the structure. So quinine, because it is quite natural that in case of bioactive secondary metabolite structure elucidation, whenever we wanted a double bond to be elucidated, whenever we wanted to know whether a double bond is there or not, unsaturations are there or not, the easy methods are, one is permanganate oxidation, second one is bromine treatment, third one is ozonolysis. So these are the 3 methods. But here bromination is one of the easiest way to quantitatively determine whether double bond is there or not, and then how many double bonds are there. Both of them can be easily determined. Hence quinine was treated with bromine, it gave them a dibromoquinine. So what does it indicate? So it means that if you compare the molecular formula, there is absolutely no difference in the carbons, no difference in the hydrogens. So only bromine number is in changing. We are adding bromines, hence it's only an addition type of reaction is happening. So that indicates that a double bond is there, C double bond C is there. And then quinine upon treatment with potassium permanganate and sulfuric acid, because this is a corrosive reaction, where so much of degradation can happen. Upon this, what scientists found is quinine is one of the compound and formic acid. So this is what they found. Quinine is actually, you see, if you compare the molecular formula, quinine has C20, quinine has C19. And then here we have C22, here we have H22. Number of oxygens are increasing. And this indicates that it has undergone some oxidative degradation reaction, most probably a carboxylic acid formation. And then formic acid is also there. So this indicated that this could be an exocyclic methylene group. So whenever you have a methylene group like this, it gets oxidized over here. So that this part will become formic acid, this part will become COOH, carboxylic acid. Further, quinine upon chromate oxidation, chromic acid oxidation, it gave them, because this is a little bit severe condition, so it got degraded. So quininic acid is one of the stable compound that is obtained after this degradation. If you compare the molecular formula, here quinine is C20, quininic acid is C11. That means it is almost half. So half of quinine. So quininic acid is one of the very important compound which helped in the structural elucidation of quinoline part in the alkali. So quininic acid upon treatment with HCl, it gave them xanthoquininic acid. Xanthoquininic. If you compare the molecular formula again, they differ by SCH2. It is almost similar to earlier we have seen one thing, that is methoxy derivative. So here, quinine upon treatment with HCl, we got epoquinine and methylene chloride. So in this way. So here also, we got xanthoquininic acid, and upon further heating, the xanthoquininic acid got oxidative, degraded, and then a carbon dioxide is evolving. So evolution of carbon dioxide clearly indicates that a carboxylic acid unit could be there in the compound, which upon heating is eliminated as carbon dioxide. Okay, so this is the way. But this C9H7NO, a very stable compound obtained at the end. Okay, so this compound was found to be similar to an already known compound. So this is 6-hydroxyquinoline molecule, which is already there in their laboratory, which is already synthesized. So while comparison of their properties, scientists found that C9H7NO, which was obtained upon thermal degradation of xanthoquininic acid, is nothing but 6-hydroxyquinoline. So in this way, quinine upon oxidation we got quininic acid, which upon treatment with HCl, most probably it has undergone demethoxylation. Because let's say if you have a methoxy group over here, that could be the structure of quininic acid. Quininic acid, something else can be there. And then upon treatment with HCl, this could have converted OCH3 to OH, which upon treatment with upon thermal degradation is giving you 6-hydroxy. So carbon dioxide could be anywhere on this ring. So further, the quinic acid. So here we have seen this one HCl, and it gave us xanthoquininic acid. So this xanthoquininic acid, quinic acid upon treatment with KMnO4 and sulfuric acid gave tricarboxypyridine. 1, 2, 3, 4 tricarboxypyridine was obtained. So the structure of this simple compound was actually confirmed by synthesis. So obtaining this compound clearly indicated that we have a pyridyl unit in the ring structure. First thing. Next one is, upon thermal degradation of xanthoquininic acid, we got quinoline. So it is an established chemistry that quinoline upon oxidative degradation with KMnO4 and sulfuric acid would give you dicarboxypyridine. Okay, pyridine dicarboxylic acid. So this is a very common reaction. So that's what clearly indicated that quininic acid is nothing but quinolin group containing methoxy group at the 6th position and carboxylic acid group at the 4th position. So this is the proposal, and this structure was confirmed by synthesis. Okay, so this is the way how half part of quinine. Quinine contains C20. So quinonic acid contains C11. So almost half of the structure of quinine was confirmed by using oxidative and acid degradation reactions. So this is the way how quinonic acid or quinoline unit ring part of quinine was confirmed. So that's why, because as we all knew, quinonic acid is actually obtained via oxidative degradation. So this carboxylic acid is actually generated upon oxidative degradation. So something else is there, it is not actually carboxylic acid. So that's why if you see the quinine part, so if you wanted to represent it, this quinoline unit and another C10H16NO is to be confirmed, so this part is to be confirmed right now. This indicated, because if you see this molecular formula, if you substitute the numbers in the degrees of unsaturation formula, you would get 3 more unsaturations are needed. We already have confirmed that there is an exocyclic methylene is there. So that's why 1 unsaturation is gone. 2 oxygens are over here. One of them is methoxy, the other one is a hydroxy group. So there is no chance of any other double bond. And upon treatment with bromine, we found only 1 double bond. So that's why it is a saturated moiety is there in this entire C10H16NO. Hence, there is a possibility of 2 more rings. So the entire component is aliphatic in nature with 1 exocyclic methylene, 2 rings are needed, 1 nitrogen is to be incorporated in it. And nitrogen is a tertiary nitrogen. So these are the boundaries within which we have to think now. And the determination of the aliphatic part in quinine. This is one of the toughest part, and which involved so much of thinking and experimentation. Quinine, upon treatment with permanganate oxidation, this we knew already. Ketanine and formic acid came. So this ketanine, upon treatment with chromic acid, we got syncholipoic acid, because upon degradation, because these degradation reactions they used to carry out. But so many degraded products will come, they repeat the experiment further and further, so that they will get a repeatable important molecule. So this is one of the product which gave us a way to determine the aliphatic part in quinine. That part is syncholipoic acid. So this molecular formula is C8H13NO4. When they isolated this compound, they found that this compound is a dicarboxylic acid. This is an aliphatic compound, a dicarboxylic acid, and which upon dehydration gave them an anhydride, acid anhydride. Just like acetic acid becoming acetic anhydride, thalic acid becoming thalic anhydride. In the same way, this compound upon degradation of ketanine, syncholipoic acid, whatever we got, is actually dicarboxylic acid. So this is forming an anhydride. So what kind of aliphatic compounds can form an anhydride? There is a rule. If a dicarboxylic acid is there in an aliphatic system, it must be either 1,2 dicarboxy or 1,3 dicarboxy. Then only it forms an anhydride. This is what we call it as Blanc's rule. Let's say, if you take this example. So here, in this case, in the first case, the both carbons are separated by 3 more carbons. Means 1,3 dicarboxylic acid. So it is giving you an anhydride. Whereas, if you go beyond this limit, upon dehydration, it is not the anhydride, but a ketone is going to come, because this carbonyl group is going to attack the beta alpha carbon, so thereby it forms a ketone, and it further removes the carboxylic acid part as a carbon dioxide. So this is an established chemistry. So this is what we call it as Blanc's rule. Hence, this is an aliphatic compound, a dicarboxylic acid, it is forming an anhydride. So logically, the two carboxylic acids must be either 1,2-dicarboxy or 1,3-dicarboxy. And syncholipoic acid further, it got reacted with the HNO2 and it is giving you nitrosoamine. It means that nitrogen is a secondary amine. It's not a tertiary amine, but here in syncholipoic acid, a degraded product obtained from ketanin is actually a secondary amine. Hence, to summarize, syncholipoic acid, which is C8H13NO4, is a dicarboxylic acid. So definitely two COOH groups will be there. C2H2O4. If you minus that, C6H11 and N will be there. So only one unsaturation. So it should be a saturated heterocyclic ring. So these are some of the examples of saturated heterocyclic rings like piperidine. So this is piperidine and then pyrrolidine and so on. Further, so this syncholipoic acid was further treated with concentrated sulfuric acid, and in one of their studies they got 4-methyl pyridine, because concentrated sulfuric acid can do so many different types of reactions where addition elimination reactions are possible. Hence, by taking that into consideration, scientists confirmed that syncholipoic acid contains piperidine unit. Probably at fourth position, a methyl group could be there. Methyl or methylene or carbon chain must be growing from here. Yeah. Further, how many possibilities are there? Now we have a piperidine part is there. Now we need to keep the carboxylic acid. So where can we keep the carboxylic acid? Because piperidine unit is symmetric, and this indicated that fourth position shall contain a carbon, either methyl or methylene. So these are the possibilities that we will get. COOH, 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 and COOH, COOH. Where this one is out of question because the two carboxylic acids are separated by 1, 2, 3, 4. And this is also not possible. So we are left with only two choices. This one as well as this one. Scientists confirmed that the one is actually the structure of syncholipoic acid. And here structural elucidation was done, structure was confirmed exclusively via synthesis. Okay, so this is the synthetic pathway where at the end of the synthetic pathway you are getting optical isomers. Upon resolution we got an alpha acid and a beta acid. So beta acid, because this particular compound we do not know their optical or orientations of this carboxylic acid and this this part also. So these two carbons means third position and fourth position, these two are chiral in nature, so we do not know their orientations, but whichever is showing properties similar to this beta acid is actually syncholipoic acid. So scientists have confirmed that this is what actually the structure of syncholipoic acid. Koenig's approach. So here we need to further this, because we need to further increase or otherwise grow further, because here syncholipoic acid is actually C8. How many carbons we need further? We need another 3 carbon. 2 carbons are needed to conclude the structure. So in Koenig's approach, so this is a different type of degradation. Earlier, what is the method that we are following? They followed either chromate oxidation or permanganate oxidation. But here we are following a different reaction where we first quinine is treated with PCl5. So it gave them a chloroderivative. If you compare the molecular formulas of these two, there is no change in carbon. There is no change in nitrogens. The only change that you can see is in oxygens, means one of the oxygen is gone and replaced by chlorine, and one of the hydrogen is also replaced. It means a chlorine is replacing a OH group. So this is quite obvious because we already knew that one of the oxygen is a hydroxy group. Okay, so this chloride derivative upon treatment with alkali, it has undergone elimination reaction, so that HCl is gone to give us quinine. This is quinine, this is quinine. An alkene was obtained. This one was then treated with phosphoric acid specific reaction conditions. It gave them two compounds. One is 6-methoxylepidine. The second part is miroquinine. So this methoxyepidine, its structure was determined, confirmed by synthesis. Miroquinine is right now a very important molecule which helped in the establishment of the remaining part of the structure. Miroquinine, it formed a monoester with ethanol, and it is forming an amide with acetic anhydride. It is forming a nitrosoamine with HNO2, and it is giving dibromo derivative with bromine, and upon chromate degradation it is giving syncholipoic acid. So what is it that we are getting? We are going to get from these observations, means it is esterified, getting esterified with ethanol. It means that miroquinine is actually a carboxylic acid, monocarboxylic acid, and it is getting amidated, so acetic anhydride. So we have an NH group here, which is further confirmed by nitrosoamine, means it is a secondary amine. It is forming a dibromo derivative, so it contains a double bond. Upon chromate oxidation, we are getting a carboxylic acid again. So these indicate that miroquinine is actually a piperidyl derivative with a structure similar to syncholipoic acid, but one carbon extra. So because here it is, chromate oxidation is actually giving you the extra carboxylic acid, either one, this one or this one. So one of these carbons must be possessing the double bond. So here, when miroquinine was treated with mercury chloride, acidic conditions gave one of the product 3-ethyl-4-methylpyridine. 3-ethyl-4-methylpyridine. So this is a very important revelation, so a very important result which confirmed that miroquinine is actually this product. Okay, a secondary amine is there, a double bond is there, and a COOH is also there. So with this, it is confirmed that piperidine unit is there in quinine, to which at the third position this allyl group is added, and one of the part from where the joint is happening, because with the quinoline part it has to be joined, so one of them is via carbon, the second one must be via nitrogen. So that is the way how we have to join this fragment to quinoline unit. Now let's see how we can glue them together, joining 6-methoxylepidine and miroquinine. Rabi's approach. So Rabi's approach is one of the very important, or we can call it as a classical organic chemistry, beautiful approach. So here, via logic only, we are going to join them together. Methoxylepidine and miroquinine, if you join these two things together, what you are going to get? You are going to get a quinine. It is not quinine. First, we are going to confirm quinine. So quinine shall contain a double bond, extra double bond, other than this allyl group, or otherwise C double bond, CH2, exocyclic methylene group. So that methylene must be there attached to the quinoline part, then only carboxylic acid formation is possible. So how can we join these two things together now? So there are two possibilities. One of them is, see, this is the CC over here, and this part is syncoloiponic acid part, CH2COOH. So if this bond is degraded, then you will be getting a carboxylic acid over here. So you can join them like this, so that you will get structure like this with the piperidyl unit, a bridged system. Or you can join from this carbon to this nitrogen, so that you will get a azepine ring with a bridged system. So this is the piperidyl unit, this is the bridged system, okay? But when Rabi's approach is like, when he analyzed the reaction conditions, he found that the reaction conditions which are giving actually the acidic degraded upon chromate oxide acid degradation product and other degradation products are possible only when we have a six membered ring like this, means piperidine and then another piperidine over here. So like this, six membered ring only can give you the reaction outputs whatever we are observing. So hence he preferred this particular unit as structure of quinine, and further he went ahead in establishing this structure, assignment of hydroxy group. The way how he confirmed this one, quinine, as we all knew, upon chromate oxidation it is going to give you quinic acid, etc. But a ketone was obtained as a minor product, okay, because when oxidative degradations are done in 1900s and before that, and how they were actually struggling to isolate a compound. They don't have a chromatography, they don't have HPLC, etc., or otherwise NMR and mass, etc. So that's why isolation of a compound is a Herculean task. But he really worked hard, and then with his meticulous operation thinking, he was able to isolate this ketone, a minor product, and determine its molecular formula. And both, when you compare, oxygens are the same, nitrogens the same, carbons are the same, but hydrogens, we don't have two hydrogens here, H2. So that indicated that one of the functional group in quinine got oxidized to quinone. Which functional group? Can we oxidize a primary, if a primary alcohol is there, upon oxidation of primary alcohol you would be getting an aldehyde group. A ketone can come only if the hydroxy group is a secondary alcohol. So it indicated that quinine now could be this, because upon oxidation there is every possibility that you are going to get a quinone, and then upon oxidation you will be getting quinic acid, and this part upon oxidation you will be getting this upon oxidation you will get syncoloiponic acid. So in this way, his proposal of having a double bond outside, or exocyclic double bond, was actually confirmed, okay? So had we have a seven membered ring over here, it would not allow you to have hydroxy group, okay? It is not at all possible. So here, if you see this, if this is the ring that we have, let's say if you have a OH group over here or somewhere else, you would not be getting some of the degraded products that we are getting from degradation of quinine. So this is the way how Paul Rabi confirmed that nitrogen is a part of this bridged system, where exocyclic methylene is over here, allyl group, and then hydroxy group is over here. Now it is to be confirmed again. See here, this aryl ring, that is what I told you, because aryl ring estimation, confirmation, etc. is a relatively easy task, because here in this we have 1, 2, 3 and 4. 4 chiral centers are there. So all these 4 chiral centers are to be confirmed. So here As I told you, the optical activity of orientation of these four places is to be fixed. So here, Prelog and Jalam, so they work for the confirmation of orientations at these chiral centers. So one of the major parties, they started from miroquinine, and they did synthetic transformation of miroquinine to ultimately obtain diethyl cyclohexane. So throughout this reaction, you can closely observe where here it is dehydrogenation, here it is a reduction, here it is reduction and nucleophilic substitution over here, here it is elimination, and here it is degradation of this nitrogen, and then by using diethyl malonate, they are again closing the ring and then removing carboxylic acid, again here elimination of halogen. So throughout, they did not touch the chiral carbons. Throughout the reaction, they did not touch the chiral carbons. Ultimately, when they observed this compound, they found that it is optically inactive. So how could this be possible? It is possible only when both the compound in both the ethyl groups are on the same side. Then you can have symmetry, so that there can be no optical activity in this molecule. So this is the way how they confirmed that in quinine, actually at these two positions, the carbons are on the same side. So in this way, they confirm the orientation of carbons over here, or substitutions over here. Now we need to confirm the chirality at these two positions. So here, first one is this part, means next to nitrogen, this carbon is to be confirmed. For our ease of understanding, I am redrawing the structure. So this is one of the representation where at this carbon we have S orientation. So carbon is coming substituted because this entire quinoline unit is attached in this way. So this is another orientation where it is R orientation is there. Now let's see how they confirmed whether quinine or quinidine has these two structures or not. So quinidine, upon treatment with HCl and heating, specific reaction conditions, I'm not giving the entire details here. So these are the two reagents that are used. So they found an ether which was obtained via intramolecular addition product between OH and alkene. So this is the ether formation, whereas quinine did not give this ether compound. Let's say if this is the structure and this is the structure, in which case we have proximity in the functional groups. So it is quite evident that here in this orientation, our allyl group over here and OH group are pretty close by, whereas here OH is very much away from allyl group, so thereby reaction is not very much possible. So that's why this could be quinidine, and then this could be the structure of ether that is possible upon reaction of this OH group with this alkene. Okay, so this is the way how they confirmed that this carbon over here is actually S oriented. So now we have confirmed this carbon over here. Let's say if you start from here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, let's say for our ease of understanding. So this third carbon is over, its conformation is fixed. Now this carbon is fixed. Now this carbon was found to be this. Okay. So in this way, they confirm orientations. So for clarity, I am representing these two carbons as in red. And here also you can see both the carbons are in red. Okay. Both are on the same side. Next, here further studies were done by Prelog and Haflingers. So their approach is, Haflinger, they were actually studying nucleophilicity or basic nature of naturally available beta hydroxyamines and their epimers, or their isomers. Okay, so here this is ephedrine and this is epsilon ephedrine, which was synthesized. Okay, both are not the same, they are optical isomers. So when they studied the basic nature, they found that naturally available isomer so are also always having lesser pKa value rather than their epimers, or other way their isomers. So by taking this logic, because here also you can see alpha beta, this is also a beta alkyl amine only. So natural compound was less basic than the epimer. So quinine upon treatment, because as I have explained earlier, quinine upon oxidation gave them a ketone. So this ketone was reduced and resolved. So upon resolution, they got two compounds. One of them has pKa 7.73, the other one has pKa 8.44. This 7.73 containing compound is actually matching with quinine. Whereas this one is its isomer. Hence, pKa is less, as it is evident from the earlier studies that natural compound was always less basic than the epimer. So this could be the compound, this could be the conformation that was fixed upon this study. Okay, is it clear? So I will repeat it again. Naturally, beta hydroxy amines that are available naturally, ephedrine is a natural product, and when its basic nature is compared with its optical isomer, okay, so here it is epsilon ephedrine, they found that natural isomers are always, because this is one of the example I am showing, they have done other examples also. So pKa was found to be, or otherwise they are found to be, less basic than their epimers or the isomers. So hence, to test this over here, they oxidized quinine to its ketone first, then they reduced it. Upon reduction, you obviously will get two isomers. So these two isomers were resolved by using different kinds of resolution techniques. So these two isolated molecules were then tested for their pKa. So pKa of this isomer was 7.73 and pKa of this isomer was, hence they found that one of the isomer has a pKa value 7.73 and the other isomer pKa value is 8.44, and they found that this isomer which has shown less pKa value is actually quinine. Okay, because when they compared the physicochemical constants, so this is matching with quinine, and this isomer is actually showing lesser pKa value. So they followed this strategy to fix the relative orientation of this hydroxy group with respect to the remaining functional groups. So in that way, they confirmed that this is the compound, this is the structure of quinine. Every one of these assumptions were confirmed by synthesis. So different type of synthetic strategies were followed, because as I told you earlier, quinine's journey from white crystalline material to a three-dimensional structure is actually more than a century, more than 100 years old journey. The first crystalline compound was isolated in 1820, but the first published synthesis is somewhere close to 1940. Okay, and its three-dimensional structure was completely established with the help of all these, as well as X-ray crystallography. This is one of the publication where X-ray crystallography data was published. So with this, scientists confirmed that with so many studies, so many people's contribution, now we have the structure of quinine as this. Dear friends, I hope you enjoyed my lecture. And if you like it and found it useful, please share it with your friends and please subscribe to my channel. Thank you very much.